Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Wake Up Missoula. I'm your host, Scott Ramph. I have a lot of stuff I have to talk about today. We got some weather. I have a mercantile time-lapse, so MCAT's been doing a time-lapse shoot of the mercantile as it's being torn down within the next couple months. I'll show you a little bit of that. Orientation is in 1 week from today, so if you want to get involved with MCAT, you're more than welcome to. I'm going to talk about summer camps. I'm going to talk about other things. I have a stop animation video for you guys, as well as news, weather, and more. But let's kick it off with some weather. If you look at it outside, it is currently 32 degrees. Your high is going to be 59, but of course, it'll be even warmer this Thursday with a high of 63 and pretty much staying somewhat that way, but it's going to get rainy later on this week as well. So if you guys are planning on going out and about on Friday for your first Friday, be aware that you have that 20 to 80% chance of rain. So there might be scattered showers and isolated rainstorms happening in and around the Missoula area. So look, I'll talk a little bit more about that and see how it is on Friday, because weather will be changing, and it's usually just because it says that it's going to rain that particular day doesn't mean it's going to rain that day. Sometimes the wind pushes the storms through here a lot quicker, so just I'll tell you a little bit more about that on Friday as well. Missoula Mercantile, the old historic mercantile is being demolished as we speak, but I have a nice little time lapse of the video itself. So as you can see, wait, let me just play that for you guys. See, we get a nice little time lapse going on there. This is about a week and a half of some of the mercantile. There's really not much going on right now. They're not doing any kind of major release, major movement. I want to thank the organization Submittable for letting us use their vantage point of the mercantile as we continue our time lapse. So, nice little All right, so speaking of historic buildings, in Missoula, Governor Steve Bullock visited the Roxy Theater, and he announced a $167,605, yes, that specific, tourism infrastructure and community development grant to the Roxy Theater. The Roxy was destroyed in an unsolved arson in 1994, rebuilt and reopened in 1998 with a new facade in front of the building, and closed again 2000 when the owners died, and then it was reopened for the International Wildlife Film Festival, brought it back in 2002. The International Wildlife Film Festival will celebrate its 40th anniversary from April 15th to the 22nd, and they hope this grant is going to help improve the facade. So a lot of times is that they're going to try to do it more historic and more of a tourism draw for a lot of people, and the idea is that they're going to have tickets being sold at a front window. So you walk to the front of the door, and then they sell tickets there. Then you walk inside the building and you go see the movies. A lot of times with the Roxy, they've been showing a lot of those kind of like second string movies that don't get a wide release in some of the theaters that you'd have, like at the Carmike Cinema here in Missoula. But they've been showing a lot of cool movies, especially some of the Oscar movies that won Oscars that you didn't get a chance to see in the mainstream theaters as well. In the state, a bill making its way through the Montana legislature would allow breweries to increase their production limit from 10,000 barrels to 12,000 barrels. So the idea of this is that in tap rooms, if you brew more than 10,000 barrels, you cannot sell beer in your tap room. So they're increasing that to 12,000. The Senate Business, Labor, and Economic Affairs Council voted to make the limit 12,000 barrels, which would be a 2,000 barrel increase from the current production cap. The Montana Brewing Association has agreed that the current production cap stifles economic growth and hampers job creation, because breweries that hit the 10,000 barrel cap must either stop selling beer in the tasting room or stop canning more beer. So House Bill 4541 which was originally introduced by Democratic Representative Ellie Hill and Republican Representative Adam Hertz, both of Missoula. They will now be heard on the floor of the Senate sometime in the next 23 days, but as early as today. The bill was approved by the House of Representatives early this year. Many breweries would feel the pressure to brew 12,000 when some startups may have a little trouble doing that. Basically, if you brew more than 12,000 barrels after this bill is passed, you cannot sell it in the tap room. Some places in Missoula cannot build on such small increments, like an additional 2,000 barrels, said some local companies here in town. For more information, you can go to Missoulian.com. In national news, it looks like the American Health Care Act is being retuned as key GOP members who didn't get enough support the first time are trying again to repeal the Affordable Care Act once again. For the next two weeks, though, the legislature will go on a recess so that the U.S. reps and senators can go home to face the constituents. The 30-member House Freedom Caucus are the ones within the GOP who are fighting among the other parties about moving forward on a repeal and replacement that didn't pass. So they're going to try a second time's the charm thing, but if it doesn't work that way, then they were quoted saying that it's quite a political risk to try to pass a bill twice. Politically, most Republicans say that they don't want to drag out the health care debate longer than they have to, and if it's clear, it cannot pass. The only thing worse than failing once to deliver on a central campaign promise is failing twice. So that's basically everything that's happening in the world, nation, and in Montana today. I have a guest from the Missoula Downtown Partnership. It's Kristen Sackett. She's the marketing and developing director for the Downtown Partnership, and she's going to be talking about some of the things that you guys can do to get involved with it. I have a couple PSAs I'm going to show you guys, and when I come back, we'll have her on here. So without further ado, here is a PSA.
MCAT is celebrating 27 years of recording and presenting the Missoula, Montana experience, our struggles and our accomplishments that mark the path to the future. We'd like to invite you to celebrate that accomplishment with a party Friday, May the 5th at the Downtown Dance Collective, 121 West Main Street.
Senior Corps at Missoula Aging Services is Missoula's volunteer hub. Hundreds of volunteer opportunities await. You can help improve reading skills, school attendance, and the well-being of students, provide services that help older adults, or find out about countless other opportunities that will capture your interest. Because your heart's desire never ages, now is the time to reinvent yourself. Discover your perfect volunteer opportunity by calling 728-768.
Hey guys, I'm here with Kristen Sackett, and she is the marketing and developing director.
Events director.
Yeah. For the downtown, Missoula Downtown Partnership. And she's here to talk about kind of like an artist call mm-hmm. for the River City Roots Festival.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, so obviously Roots Fest is the huge celebration in Missoula, and a major part of our community is obviously the arts culture and art scene. So we really want to get artists involved. So your painters, your potters, your photographers. And so we have the art show, and we really would love to have local artists come and join us. So we have an application out right now. You can visit MissoulaDowntown.com, go to the Roots Festival page, or RiverCityRootsFestival.com, and go to the art show page, and you'll be able to apply there. We'd like to have a nice mix of it, of not only your traditional artists, your fine artists like your painters, your photographers, sculptors, and stuff like that, but we've decided to kind of move in a direction of including individuals who have been at the Made Fairs, because we noticed last year we had a few people that were more akin to that end of the artist spectrum. And it actually went over really well, and that is such a huge part of Missoula culture, not only the fine art galleries, but also people who are just so creative and so talented. So we want to include both. So we definitely welcome not only fine artists to apply, but also artists who might be just making simple jewelry, doing upcycled type things. There's so much that people do out there, so we would love to have them join us.
Yeah, and I did notice that a couple of my artist friends that do a couple of these things all the time, they tend to sell a lot more of their smaller knick-knacky type stuff than they do some of their bigger stuff. So, you know, my bench didn't sell, but a bunch of my holsters did.
Yeah, and we see that a lot. And you know, people are coming to the festival and hanging out all day, so while they might love this painting, you know, it's $500 and they're like, oh, you know, I definitely want it, but maybe I'll just get their card and work with the artist after the fact, because obviously they're there to hang out at Roots Fest and walk around. But you know, their kid might see a really cute, you know, doll or something cute, and then they can put that in their purse and walk around with it. So we like having the both the affordable art for everyday people, but then the art that, you know, people who are looking to add to their collection as well.
So I definitely can see that happening for sure. It's it's a huge thing, and it's always nice to be able to take something away from like the Roots Festival.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, you have those plastic cups. Mm-hmm. You know, you have the two tickets of a beer, right? That's usually how
I think so.
And a lot of times, you see all these knickknacks. It's I don't know if I can carry around with this all the time. I kind of want to stick around. So it's nice to be able to have the option to purchase smaller things. And then be able to just walk around and still kind of stick around.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we want it to be a full experience of what Missoula has to offer. So we have the free live music. We have the art show. We do have Roots Fest merchandise. We have the food, which is, of course, majorly important for any festival. And of course, the adult beverages people enjoy, too. So it's really something for everybody at Roots Fest. And so we really want artists, you know, in the area to come and join us and just really make it a true Missoula experience for people who are visiting. Or just the community in general.
Yep. So I invited Kristen on here, and she wanted to talk about this, but also there's a whole bunch of other things that the Missoula Downtown Partnership does.
Yeah.
And there's an upcoming event that's also coming up this month, which is Missoula Fashion Week.
Yes, absolutely. You know, we love our retailers downtown. They are so unique. They're really high-spirited. They love being in downtown, and they started this, I'm not even sure how many years ago, and we really support them. It's really a way for folks to kind of shake off the winter blues, kind of the weather's turning nice. You're thinking about spring clothes. You're thinking about, hey, I haven't been downtown walking around a while because it's been an awful winter, as we all know. And it's a great way to kind of kickstart, you know, their selling season. So there's a whole list of events going on, and I'm sorry I don't have them with me. They're
and
still working
on it. And you were mentioning that some of these shops are going to be open until 9 p.m.
So on April 20th, it's going to be a ladies' night. It's the first ladies' night that we've put together, and there's between 15 and 20 different retailers that will be open till 9 p.m., which traditionally a lot of them are closed by, you know, 6 p.m. this time of year. So they'll have different kinds of discounts. They'll have drinks and snacks, and then every time you purchase something, you'll get a little raffle ticket, and you fill in your name and you put it in a little bin that they'll have at each store. And then once the night is over, we'll collect all the bins and we'll draw a couple names. I think we'll have a couple of gift baskets, so the more you buy, the more chances you have to win. And you don't have to, there's no limit. You don't have to spend a minimum of $20 to be able to do it. We just are encouraging people to explore our shop, see what they have. There's so many unique things. The shops are just so wonderful. You're going to have a really wonderful experience. So make sure you mark on your calendars April 20th, Ladies Night. Grab your girlfriends and come downtown and really enjoy a fun night shopping during Missoula Fashion Week.
Cool. And we were also a little bit talking about, you know, we were talking about, oh, are you guys looking for bands and all this stuff? But you guys are so on the ball in the Downtown Partnership that they got everything pretty much covered for your summer seasons for Downtown Tonight and Out to Lunch.
Yeah,
so you
we're
have 27 bands.
Yeah, yeah.
Already lined up.
Yep. We're working on finalizing the contracts and the schedule. So, and probably in about 4 weeks, the full schedule will be out. But if you're looking to get involved with Out to Lunch Downtown Tonight, we and your business would love to get involved with the event and support those events and help keep them free for the community. We do have lots of sponsorship opportunities. So sorry for bands, but businesses, you know, we would love to. So if a band is interested, get in contact with us next January, because we start the process pretty early because it's pretty intensive. So got to stay on top of it. We have a lot going on in our office. So
yeah. And also we some food vendors as well. We were talking a little bit about that, how you guys are doing somewhat of a new program here. Can you tell us a little bit
more about that? Yeah, so in the past, when somebody applied to be a part of Out to Lunch in Downtown Tonight, you had to commit to the whole series, and that's, you know, anywhere from 13 to 14 weeks, depending on what the calendar does. And for a lot of individuals, that's really hard to difficult to commit to 14 weeks in a row. And a lot of times people want to go on vacation, they get pulled to other events or whatever, so sometimes we'll end up with holes. And so what we're trying this year, it's a new pilot program, it's called a guest vendor program. So somebody who would love to get involved in Out to Lunch in Downtown Tonight but can't commit, but might be able to fill in for some vendors who have to go to a different event or are away on vacation or whatever it may be, we would fill them in. We would get their information, see what power needs that guest vendor needs, what kind of food it is, and then hopefully we can plug them in. It's not a guarantee, it just kind of depends on who's gone and whatever, but we want to give the opportunity to other new food vendors to get involved and test the waters and see what Out to Lunch in Downtown Tonight are all about. So definitely make sure to get in contact with us, our office, 543-4238, or check out missouladowntown.com under our events page, and there's an application there, but we're happy to answer any questions. But we hope that gives people an opportunity who might be scared of the, oh, I can't commit to 14 or 13 weeks, but they really want to get involved. So if there are any food vendors out there that are interested, definitely get in contact with us.
Cool. And kind of bringing it back to what we kind of started the interview on, missouladowntown.com, and you can contact with them. They're looking for artists and art vendors who want to sell some of their smaller art or the bigger art at the Roots Festival. Yeah. Get in contact with them, missouladowntown.com.
Yeah, definitely give us a shout. We'd love to get have a conversation with you.
All right, so I have a bunch of new programs that are going to be airing this week on MCAT. Thanks for joining me.
Yeah, thank you so much.
And we'll be right back right after this.
The dependence that we all have on public lands and experiences like this, and use that as kind of leverage to try and mobilize greater awareness. When I showed some of these slides and ideas to a group of students at Holy Cross College, which is across the street from Notre Dame but a different demographic, and all they wanted to do was ask me, well, have you seen this GoPro video, or have you seen that GoPro video when they do this amazing thing or that amazing thing? So they're, you're right, they're, we need to think more about the American West and public lands across the country, certainly.
They can protect the forest very well, but according to their ideology, they not just protect the forest. They think forest is useful for them. They don't plant forest, actually. They just cut the forest and put the grow rice in it. Then after several months, they will have sprout out. They will cut some, not one, they cut some of it and leave the good one. After 3 or 5 years, the cinder, usually cinder trees, will grow big enough to use. This is their way to do for the forest. They are not just protect.
When we did ELISAs, where you use a secondary antibody to bind the primary antibody coming from the mouse, so we use an anti-mouse antibody on the market, and it didn't work. And when you looked at the results, it looked like the mice were actually not seroconverting until we used a very specific secondary antibody against it was the anti-peromyscus. Then we were able to now show that they do indeed seroconvert. So that took like maybe 6 months or so to achieve. And another challenge with the peromyscus is that they breed slowly, especially if it's winter. For some reason, no matter how we try to change the environment to feel like it's a natural environment, but I think for some reason they have a biological clock to know that it is winter, and then they just don't breed as much.
Yeah, certainly the hope is to meet those populations before they get their adult set of teeth and be teaching them good things. So traditionally, you know, pre-sugar in places like this, decay was very rare. You know, a diet of rice and lentils, you certainly don't get that kind of widespread decay. You get the occasional cavity, but not that kind of widespread systemic decay.
What we did was we started sponsoring meals during these days when people would come and visit. So women might travel from, you know, a village that was 10 kilometers away and then have to wait there 8 or 9 hours. And we found out that a big reason that people weren't coming was because they would be hungry and they wouldn't have something to feed their kids. So we would do these enormous meal demonstrations where we'd show them the different types of peanut butters or lime for, you know, vitamin C, or, you know, moringa to increase iron intake. We would show them all these cool ways that we would add in, you know, these foods into the porridge. And then we would distribute it to them, you know, for lunchtime and let them participate as well. And then sort of month after month, what started as like a kind of weird thing that the Westerner was doing, you know, with her doctor, people would come to our clinic just like, yeah, have you heard about the good porridge that they have?
I just wanted to say a few words about vibe, just for your information. So 2 years ago, when I retired after 25 years of dancing, I was tired of ballet and I never really appreciated competitions. But then I was offered, or the opportunity came up, to take over a dance competition. And of course, that's a little bit of a problem if you're tired of dancing. So I figured I have to come up with something different. And so I thought, what are the most important things for me? That's to see the artistry on stage, because I only get, or a dancer or a ballet, even a whole ballet, gets only my attention if the artists on stage have the ability to capture my attention. And that's, I think, the most important thing, because only then the dance will never be boring, because I'm too bored by all the gymnastics that we see on stage, unfortunately, so often. And I've seen this. Thank you. So at least three people agree. That's nice.
All right. So that was the a tease for the last Vienna International Ballet Experience video that'll be appearing on MCAT this week. We've been showing a whole bunch of ballet and dance and other things with their vibe experience here in when they came down and came into Missoula, talk about their expertise and exchange of knowledge in terms of dance. I thought it was a great little performance. Performances. We live streamed it on our Facebook and YouTube pages back in the early winter that is in Missoula, but winter is far behind us right now. Most of the programs that are airing on MCAT are the last remnants of winter, so if they do make a couple jokes about winter, then you know that we filmed it during winter. Some of the other programs that are on there is the International Development Series. We got Global Public Health. The one I shot was the Global Public Health. There's Wilderness Issues Lecture Series, and we got Mansfield Brown Bag Lecture Series. There's so many lecture series that we're doing, it's ridiculous. Last night was the last Wilderness Issues Lecture Series, which I honestly can't remember what they're talking about. Public lands. They're talking about public lands. It was very interesting about how there's a interesting way of how they bait and switch in terms of public lands. Like, oh, you should let the state take care of it, and the state doesn't know how to take care of it, and they end up usually selling it to private ownership, and you basically lose all your public lands just like that. It's called the bait and switch. So in a way, I thought it was a pretty interesting talk. Wilderness Issues Lecture Series. I think this is their 41st year, 41st or 42nd year. MCAT's been doing it since early 2000s. And you can watch it anytime by going on to MCAT.org. And let me plug my website as well. If you want to find out more information, you can go to wakeupmissoula.wixsite.com/wakeupmissoula. So nice, you made you write it all twice. As you can see in the image, you see a bike right behind me from last Friday. We'll be giving away that bike at a raffle on our May 5th MCAT celebration party. I ran a PSA. Just kind of talking about where and when you can get it. It's been running on MCAT like crazy. And to find out more information about MCAT, you go to MCAT.org. I promised I'd be talking about summer camps, and I'm going to be talking about summer camps right now. So summer camps are happening as early as late June. We're going to be doing a media camp. We're doing a Raptors of the Rocky camp, which is more of like a it's more of a documentary type class where we get a chance to film a couple of the animals that come in and around the Missoula area. We also have Stop Animation Camp, and then we just kind of end on a high note with the Zombie Camp. This year, I definitely am trying to do a plan a little different. I'm trying to do a single day where we do all the zombie shooting and all the zombie stuff as well. So the thing that we're definitely going to try to do is just do a whole bunch of zombie stuff for one day. So I'm going to be trying to post an event on MCAT so you guys can learn more information about it by going on to our Facebook page, Missoula Community Access Television. And also I'll repost it from my Wake Up Missoula page, Wake Up Missoula on Facebook. And you can follow us on Twitter at Wake Up Missoula. So next week is our orientation at MCAT, 500 North Higgins. We host an orientation every second Wednesday of the month at 5:30 p.m. If you guys are interested in partaking in anything that has to do with MCAT, you guys are more than welcome to. It happens every single second Wednesday of the month. You get to learn video editing, video production, all that stuff to make your own video, whether that be a morning show, a stop animation. We do Saturday drop-in animation every Saturday for kids 9 to 13. I make a stop animation video every week for my morning show, every single Wednesday to kind of tease our Saturday drop-ins, but also just kind of continue the story of what I have no idea where this is going, but at this point, I don't really care. So without further ado, here's Cops and Pirates based on my stop-motion anthology.
I don't see why we don't go to the same coffee house we have always gone to before.
Listen, it's not that the service is terrible, it's just really annoying.
Excuse me, you're eavesdropping on us.
Listen, guys, I'm here to rob you, so hand over all your wallets and all your money that you have on you.
Well, there's two of us, I'm only one of him.
Well, you got a problem with me? I can take you both on. What do you got to say about that?
Yeah, I am Officer Pirit. What seems to be the problem here?
He's robbing us.
Okay. What we're gonna do...
Excuse me.
What is it, citizen?
You seem a little rough to be a police officer.
Yes, I agree. My gang has intel that says that pirates have infiltrated the police.
Great, just what I need. Two gangs.
Hey, what's going on over here? Mitch, is that you?
Well, look who it is. My old...
What's going on here?
You guys are being hustled by this police officer. I know the police were hiring pirates.
You just don't get it.
What are you doing over here? What's going on?
Hello, Sergeant. We're so glad you're here. This pirate... It seemed like these two citizens have attacked this unfortunate soul.
What?
Excuse me?
You've got to be kidding. That's enough out of you two. What happened here?
These two behind me, they attacked this citizen. They used that coffee pot behind me to throw it at the man's head.
And what about him?
Here, he's not important.
I can't believe this.
All right. Time to go.
I can't believe this is unfair.
You have the right to remain silent.
Officer, it was that man. It was the man who did this.
I heard it all before.
What's going on here?
Let me out of here.
It looks like it's getting a little hot in here. Oop.
I can't believe this is happening. What a shame.
Looks like we made our quota today, right, boss?
Hey guys, welcome back. I got some city council for you guys. So the city of Missoula, they were talking. The city of Missoula, they chose to divest from Wells Fargo for banking practices that do not stand with Standing Rock, but along the same lines as having some issues with opening accounts under people without their permission. There's just a couple things that Wells Fargo has been dealing with along those lines, but here's a couple public comments basically from the city of Missoula thanking the city of Missoula for what they're doing. And we're going to start off this one with Joseph Grady thanking Missoula for divesting from Wells Fargo.
It is a critical issue that faces Montana aside from just North Dakota. The headwaters of three major rivers begin here in the state of Montana, leading to both coasts and the Gulf. We are the front line of the headwaters of the United States. Those banking entities that have operated in North Dakota have their eyes on our state. We move forward to fight the XL Keystone Pipeline here in our own Montana to protect our own waters. We encourage you to look into those banking practices as well. Continuing on a statement that was made before by one of my colleagues, is that this is a responsibility for all of us, aside from just our states, our cities as well. And so moving forward, a statement like divestment is a huge message to corporations, to banking entities, to financial institutions that believe that they own Montana over Montana state residents.
All right. So that was Joseph Grady thanking the city of Missoula and also giving his two cents about how he feels about Wells Fargo and other banks that could have shady practices in terms of working with the Keystone XL pipeline. The next one is Lauren Pinsky. He talks in favor as well.
You guys have spent a great deal of time and energy and money trying to preserve our water, trying to protect our water. You're doing a great job. Taking over Mountain Water is essential for our community. I think divesting our funds from Wells Fargo is saying the same type of thing. We're standing in solidarity with other people who are trying to protect their water supply. So I encourage you to vote to divest our funds from Wells Fargo. And thank you for your work.
Thank you, Mr. Chris. Anyone else this evening? Yes, ma'am.
My name is Eileen McGardner, 701 Stevens. I'm a mom here in Missoula. I'm also a student at the university. And divesting is the next step, and there are more steps to take, and I just encourage us to continue moving forward.
All right, so as you can see, that the theme of a lot of the public comment at the city council meeting was in favor of divesting from Wells Fargo. Let's see here. It is safe to say that most of the comments were in favor of it. The city did move forward in divesting from Wells Fargo, and they the whole idea is that they're going to try to find a smaller bank or even have another bank. So it's kind of like what they're trying to do is go for the lesser of two evils. But they're going to divest from Wells Fargo, and it seems like there was a pretty unanimous decision in doing that as well. Moving on. Jack Walton, he does a committee's report, and he talks about the Missoula Public Library and a couple of the art boxes in the downtown area, just kind of giving an update of what is happening in and around the Missoula area in terms of the lot of where the Missoula Public Library is.
They're only limiting parking to 80 spots, and so that was a question asked about how come they didn't consider more parking. But again, you know, with the transportation plan, walking, biking, buses, and things like that. So, and then the library is going to be designed with sustainable building materials. It'll be LEED designed, and it has a 100-year life. Sustainable building materials. They have raised between $2 and $3 million of the $5 million from private match. Then we had a presentation on the future of traffic signal boxes. As you know, as you drive down the street, you see these traffic signal boxes that are painted, and there's some that are being replaced by the state of Montana Department of Transportation. There are new boxes, and so there's anywhere from 5 to 9 that are not painted, and so the Art Council is working with artists to come up and paint those and beautify the city. Another presentation we had was downtown apartment complex by Robin O'Day, Farron Realty Partners, and talked about proposal for the apartment complex, student housing being close to downtown, but also fairly close to the university. It will be across the street from the library on Front Street. And they're looking at individual units up to about 500, and down on the ground floor will be 6,000 square feet of small shops and things like that.
All right, so that was Jack Walton. He was talking about a little committee's report about the certain area where the new student housing, which is going to be across from the Missoula Public Library. Talk a little bit more about that. If you want more information and you want to see the whole entire city council meeting, all 87 minutes of it, you can go to ci.missoula.mt.us. It's a nice little website. Just kind of gives you everything you need to know about what's happening in the city in terms of government projects and how you can get involved as well with committees. They're always looking for input of Missoula residents. You have to be a Missoula resident to be involved with any local government here in the city of Missoula, but you're more than encouraged to be a part of it because they're always looking for people to get involved. So go to ci.missoula.mt.us. That completes the city council report. There was also a portion of Brook Street up near the Stevens Center, where you know, like where they have the Little Caesars Pizza. They are working on a proposal for new sidewalk improvements. And they're talking a little bit about like, we need a sidewalk improvement, but we also need other things as well. So there are a couple of people who own a couple of the property, the buildings near the Little Caesars up on Brook Street, talking about how they think they can try to see what else they can put in the new sidewalk improvement area along the lines of sidewalk improvement. You can Google City of Missoula to find out more information about that, and you can also go to ci.missoula.mt.us. I have an art clip for you guys, and it is one that's happening at the Missoula Art Museum, and I believe it is Ryan Feddersen, and it'll be going on until April 22nd. So without further ado, here is an art clip, and when we come back, I'll talk everything you need to know about what's happening in and around Missoula in terms of events from MissoulaEvents.net. Thank Rick Phillips for providing that art clip. That art clip won't last much longer, and that art installation will also not last that much longer in the month of April. So First Friday, it's coming up this Friday. I'll do all your First Friday events as well, just kind of give you a little guide to your art walk of where you should go and where you and what you can see for your art walk. I'll have a nice little over-the-shoulder graphic for you guys, kind of highlighting the art that will be going on, as well as pre-critic and more. But let's talk about some of the things that are kicking off your Wednesday. You got the Christian experience in 19th century Japan. Learn a history lesson at the University of Montana as they mark 150 years of Japan Meijin regime and the foundation of modern Japan after 250 years of near total seclusion from the West. Miss Sheldon's book sheds new light on the Protestant missionaries' work with Japan's leading democracy activists and their role in the helping transformation from Japan from a feudal nation ruled by shoguns, samurai to lead an industrial powerhouse of Asia's first democracy. So it was their transition from feudal Japan to modern Japan, and they did it a lot faster than anyone has ever done it in the history of mankind. Wild food, getting wild, a Green Path Herb School. Did you know that there are that there is a bounty of free healthy food that surrounds you in Montana? Join herbalist and wild food enthusiast Shauna Poily for an informative evening of local and wild food education, discussion, and recipe swapping. Meet others with foodies and bring your friends. We're going to get wild. It's $20, but you get to learn what you can actually eat in and around the Missoula natural area. But here are some of your library events. You got Makerspace Journal Cover Decor Day Session 2. So in the Makerspace at the Missoula Public Library, you get to basically decorate your journals and diaries. It would be cool. At 12:30, My iPad and My iPhone at the Missoula Public Library. So you get to learn the difference between an iPad and an iPhone, because it seems like iPads are getting smaller and iPhones are getting bigger. So you guys can check that out at the Missoula Public Library at 12:30. I don't know if that's actually what it's about, but that's the title of it. Open hours in the Makerspace starts at 3:30 in the afternoon at the Missoula Public Library. Check it out. You can 3D print. There's a lot of cool things at the Missoula Public Library. Yeah, middle school writers group. So if you're in middle school and if you have a kid that's in middle school who's kind of struggling with writing, or somebody who needs encouragement in terms of their writing, or if you think that they're very creative but they could always use some constructive criticism in terms of building their repertoire of writing and literature skills as well. So that starts at 3:30 after school today at the Missoula Public Library. If you don't want to write or read, you can watch a movie at the Missoula Public Library at the Big Sky Branch at Big Sky High School at 3:45 p.m. It's a film, and you guys can find out later on as well. But they're also initiating they're bringing back a Socrates Cafe, and let me talk a little bit about that. Please join for an informal yet intelligent and lively discussion of topics relating to the core areas of philosophy as part of National Poetry Month. Missoula Public Library will be hosting at 6 p.m. And I believe it will be in the boardroom every first Tuesday of the month at 6 p.m. They're doing a Socrates Cafe, and you guys can totally check that out. Learn, talk about philosophy, learn a little bit about what it means to be human based on the Roman Empire. Moving on, the Mad Woman of Chalant. At the University of Montana, it's a delightful and poetic satire. The Mad Woman of Chalant, I'm totally butchering that, I'm sorry, has been a beloved fixture of world theater since it premiered in the 1940s. It's a commentary on the absurdities of rampant capitalism is perhaps the more present today than ever. Countess Aluria, a countess is an aging idealist who tries to see only the beauty and happiness of the world. But after overhearing the dastardly plans of some Parisian bigwigs, she realizes that she and a merry band of outcasts from her neighborhood must take matters into their own hands. A delightful and poetic satire, The Mad Woman of Chalant will be as beloved fixture of world theater since its premiere in the 1940s. It's commentary on the absurdities of rampant capitalism, perhaps the more present today than ever. I know I said that again, but tickets are $9 for general admission, $6 for required students. The University of Montana is pleased to present this play. It's a French classic described as one part fantasy, two parts reason, and it will be running at the Masquerade Theater at the Performing Arts of the University of Montana in the Par TV building on campus from April 5th today to April 9th, which is a Sunday, I believe. Let's talk about some of the music events that are happening. Jazz Night is happening at the Top Hat Lounge at 7 p.m. You got vocal and piano duet at the Plains United Methodist Church. It's classical music. 7:30, a karaoke contest is going to be at the Eagles Lodge starting at 8:30 p.m., along with crap-tested karaoke at the Badlander and rocking country karaoke at the Sunrise Saloon. And those are all your events for your Wednesday. Let's dive into your Thursday events, starting with final round of Book Madness. Missoula Public Library, the Big Sky Branch's Book Madness, a March Madness-style tournament of books where book characters face off this year from categories like dragons, wizards, aliens, and more. And you can find out more information by going to MissoulaEvents.net. And it's going to be at the Missoula Public Library starting at 10 a.m. Tomorrow morning. Printmaking galore at the Zootown Arts Community Center is happening tomorrow afternoon at 2:15 p.m. It's from 2:15 to 5:30 p.m. This unit is a chance to explore their wonderful world of printmaking, learn how to screen, relief, and monoprint using the variety of colors and surfaces. It's $95 and $85 for members of the Zootown Arts Community Center. It's usually for associated with supplies and more, and the lesson as well. Glow in the Dark Beetles is going to be at the Missoula Insectarium to kick off Beetlemania Month here in the Missoula Insectarium. They will be learning all about lightning bugs and their amazing ability to glow in the dark. You will get a chance to learn all about these amazing beetles while doing a fun project that you can take home with you. Stop at any time between 3 and 5 p.m. Tomorrow afternoon. Kids Clay class for ages 5 to 12 at the Clay Studio of Missoula. In this class, students will explore the variety of sculptures, themes, and practices of artwork in using clay, pinching, rolling, and slip, and scrolling to build a solid foundation for diverse exploration. There's a documentary film screening of Paper Tigers. The Parenting Place in Sentinel High School presents a free screening of a documentary film, Paper Tigers. This film will be shown at 6 p.m. on Thursday, April 6th, in the front auditorium of Sentinel High School. This will be the first of two screenings of Paper Tigers in lieu of April's Child Abuse Awareness Month. Paper Tigers chronicles a year of the life of a Lincoln High School in the community of Walla Walla, Washington. The kids who come to Lincoln have a history of truancy, behavioral problems, and substance abuse. After Lincoln's principal is exposed to research about the effects of adverse child experiences, ACEs, he decides to radically change the school's approach to discipline. You got Perspectives of Lewis and Clark Art by Hal Stearns, Lolo Community Center. The people, landscape, and events of the amazing stories all come to life because of art, says historian and storyteller Dr. Hal Stearns, who has traveled and guided the rivers and trails of Lewis and Clark from Thomas Jefferson's to the Pacific Ocean. He said he's going to discuss the art associated with expedition, the good and the bad, accurate and questionable. Hal says, and some of the art is funny, silly, and downright wrong. I will share my take among many other artists who have depicted the history. Expect to see some of the works of Charlie Russell, Edgar S. Paxson, Charlie Fritz, Bob Morgan, and J.K. Ralston, all Montanans and all great artists. Hal notes J. Clymore, C.A. Grindy, Eugene Dabb, and Michael Haynes are the favorites, and some will miss the mark. That's going to be at the Lolo Community Center, and it's Perspectives of Lewis and Clark Art, 7 p.m. tomorrow. Here are some of your music events happening for your Thursday. You got the annual Dana Gallery Reading and Fundraiser at 5:30 p.m., you get Country Dance Lesson with Kathy Clark again for your Thursday night starting at 7 p.m. The UM Opera Theater presents The Rivals at the University of Montana. Live jazz is going to be at 5 p.m. And you got Mandolin Orange is going to be at the Top Hat Lounge. It's going to be acoustic folk. You got Western Front is going to be at the Sunrise Saloon. Honeycomb is going to be at Monk's, which is the DJ. You got Open Mic at the Broadway. You got Rock and Carry hosted by Aaron B. Rocks. You got Rooster Sauce Residency Week 1 at the VFW. And they'll be playing, I'm sure they'll be playing all month long. So you guys can check that out by going to MissoulaEvents.net. One thing that really caught my eye was the UM Opera Theater presents The Rivals. So let me talk a little bit more about that. This delightful, witty comedy comic opera by American composer Kirk Mincham plays April 6th and 7th at the UM Recital Hall at 7:30 p.m. Tickets are $11 generals, $6 for seniors, $5 for students at the door, or you can go to GrizzTix to join the UM Opera Theater for its tuneful comic romp by distinguished American composer Kirk Mincham. Beautiful Lydia Larkspur dreams of loving an improvised artist, impoverished artist. Sir Jack Absolute knows this, so he woos and wins her disgust as Waverly, a starving composer. Soon, Jack's father and Lydia's guardian, Mrs. Malaprop, insists that Lydia make a proper match to a young man in her own class. Now Jack must woo her as himself and explain his earlier disguise. In fact, he becomes his own rival for the love of the fair Lydia. How does this turn out? Comic chaos ensues. So it sounds like a pretty interesting thing. It's kind of like The Prince and the Cobbler meet, Mrs. Doubtfire? I don't know what to say. But you can check this out. This is going to be playing at the At the UM Recital Hall tomorrow and Friday, 7:30 p.m. It's called The Rival, hosted by the UM Opera Theater. So check it out. It's going to be great. And that concludes everything you need to know about what's happening in and around the Missoula area. I believe I haven't I've not touched base on pretty much everything, but if you want to find out more information, you can go on to my website, wakeupmissoula.wixsite.com/wakeupmissoula. So nice, we made you write it all out twice. You can subscribe to me on my YouTube channel, like me on Facebook, and follow me on Twitter. I have a whole bunch of videos I post, as well as interviews. You go to videos to see other in the canned videos. You get to see Teen Talk, you get dubbing stuff, you get interviews. You can see my last interview with the other folks as well. Gotta change that. Stop Animation is gonna be updated, as well as Flagship Friday will be coming up this Friday. Because it is Flagship Friday, I have a new Flagship Friday, which I'm very excited to show you guys. It's a very special one that I did with the Hellgate High School students, and I can't wait to show you this Friday on MCAT. Stay tuned. There's a whole bunch of new programs happening on MCAT this whole week. A whole bunch of lecture series talking about environmentalism, what about development in other countries, and how they deal with basically becoming more sustainable with less, rather than expecting a whole bunch of money to be thrown at them and be like, oh, here's a whole bunch of money, make things work. So I think there's going to be a lot of cool little lectures happening on MCAT. You can go to MCAT.org to find those and more. And if you want to go on video on demand, you go to this website, you click on our link, Channel 189, and it brings you to this nice little page, and it gives you a nice little schedule thing. And if you can see the green arrows next to the titles, that means you're able to play any of these videos at any time. As you can see, nice little representation of this video. And there's so much content on MCAT, it's ridiculous. So thanks for joining me, and I'm going to stop talking because I'm literally trying to figure out things to say. Go to MCAT.org to sign up for our raffle, because we'll be giving away a bike on our May 5th party. You guys are welcome to join us. It's going to be on the first Friday in May, May 5th, from 5 to 8 p.m. at the Downtown Dance Collective, and you guys can join us that day. We're going to have virtual reality, and we're going to do some virtual reality on Earth Day, April 22nd, our actual birthday, but we're going to be celebrating it with free cycles on April 22nd, where you guys can learn. Actually, it's more about Earth Day and just kind of like just celebrating the Earth on Earth Day on April 22nd, which is a couple Saturdays from today. Next week is orientation. Come on down, learn about television production and more, and what MCAT's all about. You can call us at 542-6228, otherwise known as 542-MCAT. And if you want to learn more information about our summer camps, go to MCAT.org, because there's a whole bunch there. And I'm pretty sure I didn't touch base on everything. So once again, MCAT.org is your resource for everything MCAT. So for Wake Up Missoula, I'm Scott Ramp. Thanks for joining for Wake Up Missoula.